two items. The board voted three directors in favor, with Director Smallman voting against, to approve a cost of living adjustment under Section 2 of the district manager's employment agreement, a copy of which is available on the board's website. And on the other item, and that was for item 4A, and on two of the other items, item 4B and C, the board voted unanimously 4-0 in favor of authorizing district council to file a cross complaint in former district council Mark Hines and his firm as cross defendants in the case brought by Terry Vieira. So, let's move on with the agenda. And are there any additions or deletions to the open session agenda?
Scott has none.
Any directors? Seeing none, let's move on to oral communications. And this is the portion which is appropriate for the public to comment on any matter within the subject matter of the district, which is not on tonight's agenda. Would anybody like to comment during oral communications?
Can I ask real quick, what was the cost of living, what percentage increase was that for the district manager?
I have a number in my mind, but to quote that.
3%? 2.5%?
I don't want to quote that without looking it up for sure.
In the ballpark.
Okay. 3 or 4%, okay, is my estimate of what that is.
Okay.
Somewhere in that range. But that may not be precise. And we should reference the whoever generates cost of living adjustments.
We can get that information.
So.
May I ask that anyone that would like to speak come to the lectern? Because I have a recording device there, so I can get the information.
Okay. Would anybody else like to speak during oral communication? I don't see anybody's hand up, so I'll close out general oral communications and move on to unfinished business. Item 9A is the 2017 education grant reports. So I
going to turn it over to Jen and have her give a presentation on the education grants.
Okay. As you all know, every year the Colorado District sponsors a grant program, a watershed education grant program that educates students and adults in San Lorenzo Valley about issues around water quality, watershed health, and in an effort to really improve the education of our community around our water sources, most of which are surface water, or about half is from surface water and half from groundwater. And so last year, the district funded 6 grants, I believe, 5 of which have returned their final reports. So the total for those grants was $13,000 for these 5 grants, and I'll tell you a little bit about them. I won't take too much time, just a little bit. The elementary school science teacher at the San Lorenzo Valley Elementary School program called Environmental Awareness Through Science Literacy, K-3 Science Enrichment at the San Lorenzo Valley Elementary School, was awarded $2,500, and that money went to programming for students at San Lorenzo Valley Elementary from kindergarten to third grade. It reached hundreds of students. I can't remember exactly how many. It was quite a lot. And then there was another $2,500 to the elementary school for Family Science Night, which is a really wonderful program that I think fourth grade science teacher puts on there at San Lorenzo Elementary School, which is open to families and members of the community, and it's been really well attended. And they work with the Discovery Museum in San Jose to set up different science displays, and most of them are related to water. They have an outdoor section with watershed displays and an indoor section on chemistry and water chemistry and things like that. They're very popular. I've done that twice. And the San Lorenzo Valley Middle School received a grant for $3,000 for an outdoor preserve for education, which is sort of an outdoor classroom that has, we've helped to fund Museum of Natural History for exploring San Lorenzo River. One of those tours, there were, I think, 14 tours or something in the San Lorenzo River watershed. One of them I led at the Olympia watershed. It was well attended. And all of those have been very well attended. And the last one was to the Coastal Watershed Council for the Watershed Rangers Program. I'm working with a few, just a select number of kind of advanced science students at the high school. And they take them out and do really sort of concentrated, focused watershed education on a broad variety of topics from groundwater recharge and water quality and forest health issues that are all related to water. And so the grant reports are all available on the board agenda, and I would recommend that the board approve the grant reports, and that way we can finalize the contracts with these five grant recipients.
Just want to point out that there were 1,000 student experiences with that elementary one. It's on page 2 of their report about them.
I'd like to comment on page 2 also. I was really impressed by where does all the water go. I was thinking that those four items at the bottom of that page wouldn't be bad for some of the elementary school kids and the educators that brought them to that level of knowledge to be explaining to the community and the directors about how watershed works and where does that water go and how do we get it back.
Just another couple comments. I didn't make it this year, but I went to the previous year's science night that was really great. And I didn't get a chance to go this last year, but that previous year was really wonderful. And I did get a chance to go up to see that slope outdoor classroom when it was nearing completion. They did not have signage up. This was a few months ago, so I have not been back since. Then, but it is accessible. It's on the middle school campus.
Margaret is something.
I am.
Okay. Any thoughts?
This is a fond part of my love for the district. I've been a long supporter of it. Came kind of up through the ranks. As a member of the Water Education Commission, and am always delighted to see the students' work and the contributions that these small grants make so significantly to our community. So I'm always delighted. And like Dean said, the science night is cool. I wish I could have found this last year. I was in some other part of the state. But it's a fun night, and I would encourage members of the public to volunteer as well and contribute to the science panel reviews that are offered to the students as they refine their project for science fair.
Okay, let me open it up to the public. Anybody want to comment? Okay, I don't see anybody wanting to comment on this item. Bring it back to us. I'm really pleased. There's a few names in here. I mentioned people I bumped into. I had no idea that they were involved in this. They're good people. Occasionally I see somebody who not only runs one of these projects, but then helps out somebody else doing it. So I think we've got a good community where people pitch in on these things. And I think by doing that, we get a lot out of a pretty small expense on these things. And it won't be too long before these people are involved in our community. And it'll be good to have people understanding our natural world out there.
My only comment is a couple of years ago, I was talking to a friend of mine who had a student at the high school, and he had gone through the Watershed Academy and came home and chastised his parents about all the things they were doing wrong, which was his perfect educational opportunity for a 14-year-old. And she commented that that was the only thing he seemed excited about at school that year. And I know it's not one of these projects, but our goal is to educate the whole community through these grants by chastising parents or whatever it takes. So I appreciated hearing that feedback from her on that particular grant program. I'm sure it's equally effective at this earlier stage of, you know, the educational process, so.
Any other board comments on this or staff? And I think I don't see any. Do we need to formally vote on this?
We'd like to have a formal vote so we can close out the contracts.
Okay, very well. But I hear a motion to accept the five grants that are in tonight's agenda item.
I'll make a motion to.
That's okay.
Okay. If there's no further discussion, then do we need to call a voice vote, I believe, on this because one director is not physically present. So Holly, could you call a voice vote?
President Bachman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
Yes.
And motion carries 4-0, the full complement of the board as it exists right now. So let us move on to the second item of unfinished business on tonight's agenda, which is the vacancy in the office of the board of directors. So, would staff want to say anything? I can.
No.
This pretty much speaks for itself. Regrettably, one of our directors had the need to resign for health issues, and we had been operating with a four-member board for a while. This has been noticed properly, and we've received two applications. So, at this point, I think I would like to open it up to the public. Those two applications are for John Dodge Hayes, who is a citizen member on our Budget and Finance Committee, and Lou Ferris, who is a well-informed, active participant in our with our board, and who has served in the past on one of our committees back in 2014. So both good folks, and I appreciate them both submitting applications and being willing to fill this empty position. So would anybody in the public like to comment upon the process here or the applicants who are present or who have submitted applications? And I don't see any public members wanting to comment on this, so I'll bring it back to the board. Any thoughts from?
Well, I will say I currently serve with John on the Budget and Finance Committee. I serve with Lou on the Citizens Advisory. I found them both really engaged, smart people that seem to really be interested in the best outcome for the ratepayers in the water district. So I'm glad that we got two candidates. So I too was pleased. I would, with our current capital improvement project coming into the active phase, I would like to have John on primarily because he has such a good bead on our current financial situation. He has a very detailed understanding of finances. And not that Lewis couldn't get there, but this way I think John could hit the ground running on the finances part in particular. I think we both applications are great and both people would be effective as directors. That would be my preference.
Bill or Margaret?
I have almost exactly the same sentiments as Jean, and furthermore, I would support John's application, not because Lou isn't also a strong candidate, and I appreciate his strong support of the district and his participation. I have really enjoyed John's approach at how he is a unifier and a problem solver and a solution finder in a way that is very helpful and very refreshing. So I would support John's candidacy.
Okay. Jean and I are both on the Budget and Finance Committee, so John has been on that committee with the two of us. I very much appreciated his qualifications. They're exemplary for financial matters. John has also been the president of a mutual, so he's had hands-on experience running a small water system, and was instrumental in getting that system into a better place with us. So I appreciate his experience beyond the finances on that. And I especially value his temperament and his abilities to reach out to others. And I think his participation with a good wrap-up of the surcharge with Montego was invaluable. And I heartily support, okay, John. I appreciate Luke for putting his name in here, and I hope he continues to be an active participant with our water district. But, okay, that's all I have to say about it.
I know, I've gotten to know both gentlemen, and I really like work with John on the Montego surcharge, and that was pretty much a close call with me, but a very close call, so, but I'd like to place my vote for Lou, for what, you know, why did he get 20 votes?
President Bachman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
No.
Okay. Matter is passed. Three directors in favor. So I believe we have some procedural matters we need to complete at this time. So, this is a swearing-in ceremony.
That didn't work.
You got to get sworn in.
Okay, Bruce.
You got to get sworn in.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Could you raise your right hand, please?
I will.
I, say your name.
I, John Pates.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support and defend.
That I will support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
The Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States.
To the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
That I will take this obligation freely.
That I will take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties upon which.
The duties upon which.
I am about to enter.
I am about to enter.
Very well.
Thank you.
and that is the appeal to the board for further adjustment of their water bill by L. Fraser.
This water use on private property are probably the single most difficult subject matter for this district to deal with, because we greatly sympathize with residents having use on the property, since that's one of the main things our staff deals with pretty much daily in the district system. We have a policy in place that provides an adjustment, a one-time adjustment of half of the bill for leaks. And last year, we went through an effort to adjust that policy to transition to a one-time event versus what was in the past a one-month adjustment, trying to hit an event, because oftentimes events don't pay attention to the stopping and starting of the meter reading month, and they cross over two different months. We have a situation such as Ms. Fraser where one event, regardless of which month or billing cycle it happened in, was very significant and resulted in a very large water bill. As I understand, I was not here for the last board meeting, but as I understand, Ms. Fraser was asked to kind of give us some thought and see if she could develop a modification to the policy, which she did, and we're here tonight to discuss any modifications to the policy, including Ms. Fraser's. Staff would like to point out that the leak adjustment policy is an effort to help. It's not intended to be punitive, it's intended to actually help the customers, recognizing the difficulty in finding leaks, particularly in large parcels. District staff would also like to recognize that the meters for the district are for district use. Any additional use beyond reading for district billing is tertiary. And I'm referencing notifying residents potentially about leaks on their property or issues along that regard. And then the third issue is that we do, and we are in the process of replacing outdated old meters that are due for replacement, and we're replacing them with cellular meters that do provide information through the net, through the internet, to both the district and customers if the customers choose to do so. However, that program can't be done, it can't be installed on an as-needed basis. Staff looked at and considered the idea of maybe accelerating that program if certain individuals or residents or ratepayers were willing to pay to have the meter installed early. We would go out there and we would get that meter installed. However, doing so creates significant financial problems, staffing problems for the finance department and for the operations department, because meters are read in what we call at staff level books, and those books represent neighborhoods, and we read them in blocks. And if we have one, two, or three meters in that block that are not being read the same way, it creates additional burden on staff. And to try and manage that across an 8,000 meter district is potentially extremely problematic. And so staff talked itself out of offering an accelerated program. Staff is currently researching the ability to point residents in the direction of private water meter programs or retail devices that the residents can provide, can buy for themselves and put on their system that they can then monitor their water usage on their own. I don't have a full description of the retail offerings right now. We're going to develop that, hopefully present that at a future board meeting and put that on the website. So residents that are waiting for the cellular meters to be installed, and it is a 7-year process to get meters swapped out across the district. So we are about 2 years into a replacement program, so we've still got about 5 years to go before all the meters are swapped out at a minimum. That is a $1 million program, so it's not a small number. It's not like you can just divert that money into a meter replacement program. And it's a staffing issue too as well, so we don't have the staff to do that. But in the meantime, we would like to provide at least a pointer to retail options for the residents. Regarding the proposal presented tonight, and this is as I understand it, I would hope that the ratepayer would be here tonight to make sure I understand it correctly, because reading things and writing things are oftentimes two different situations. So what is being proposed is that anything up to 500% of average use would be waived, and anything above 500% would apply to the leak adjustment policy. That's how I understand that. That presents a significant financial hardship for the district. I think that the staff calculated that out, and it came out to approximately this year alone, it would have been an $80,000 loss. Steph, is that right? Do you remember?
No, I think it was an additional, like, 20.
25,000. So there'd be an additional $25,000 write-down for the district this year if we had implemented this policy, which is a substantial amount of money. So staff regrettably appreciates the situation, but I don't think staff can support the recommendation as written in regarding the writing off of 500%, if I understand it correctly. But staff does support the addition of a single event spanning no more than two consecutive billing cycles. Staff definitely supports that. We were there last year, we just didn't get it across the finish line, so we'll have to see that happen again at some point in the near future. With that in mind, I'll turn it back to the chair.
Well, I'd like to take it to the person who brought this to us first, and would you like to speak? Okay.
Well, no, I just want to, the way I wrote it, I'm just proposing that anyone that has a monthly adjustment, it's the burden on the individual is reduced, so that the maximum bill that they get would be 500 times their regular water bill, versus like 2,000 or 3,000 times their regular water bill. Is that
okay?
Are we on the same page?
We are now. Like I said, what I read and what you write, and then
if your water bill is $100 a month, then after $500, that would be waived.
Okay.
So you would pay 500 times your regular water bill. So my proposal is just to have a maximum damage control for individuals that have a one-time leak, that they don't have a meter, they don't have a smart meter, they have a one-time leak, and that it doesn't present them with financial hardship because they have a one-time leak. I now have a meter, and which is great. And I never know, but for people that don't have a meter, like how are they to know that they could just be presented with this bill for thousands and thousands of dollars? And it just seems like overly punitive.
Not as big as what this woman has gone through, but it's my understanding that you can't give away water. So to say, because it's a big bill, you shouldn't have to pay it, I'm not comfortable with that. I think it's one thing to say, we're not giving you an assessment, you know, that you still have water, you know, you're taking too long a shower, but in her case, it was something that she didn't know about, and fixed as soon as could be done. But I still can't think of people just take away, you know, a big bill.
Anybody else?
My only concern with the process is we don't want to get in an ordinance 8 situation where we're doing reactive policy making. Where, and I do think the tendency is just because there's an outrageous event like this that really is outrageous, that we will shift the policy for the entire district because there's a real standout issue in it. And the old ordinance 8 was full of those kind of weird little nuggets of policy that didn't make any sense, that were probably instituted because of some crazy one-time episode in the distant past, but they didn't really relate to the general situations within the district. And so just as a policy level decision, I'm concerned about making reactive policy changes. Although, you know, there are, clearly it's not whole cloth here. There are sections here that, you know, perhaps have more merit than others. Some of the proposed changes, obviously, we more sense than others. But just want to make that comment first and then hear what everybody else says about the specifics of the policy.
So I've taken a moment to take a look at some other example leak adjustment policies, and they are, in some respects, a little bit more lenient than ours. And while I appreciate that $25,000 is real money, I would like to point out that the water falls out of the sky for free. And it's not unreasonable for us to expect that leaks be repaired promptly and that we afford our conscientious customers some relief. Other water districts say, you know, it has put the amount of adjustment in varying percentages. Some say 75% of the overage without a cap. Some say, both that I looked at just recently have said within 5 years, a customer can apply for a leak adjustment once in every 5-year period. It's not an indefinite for the lifetime of that customer's account. It's in a 5-year period. And they often span billing cycles with the understanding that a leak may span those time frames before it's found. So to Jean's point, if we make a decision tonight, we may not have enough information to fully address all of the pieces and parts that we want to take a look at in reforming or adjusting this policy. One part of the policy is the question about, is the relief appropriate? Is the relief adequate? Another part of it is the time frame of identifying the leak and responding to the leak appropriate? And still a third is, how often may a customer apply for such a leak adjustment? Once, and that's one and done, or once in every specific period of time? So I'd like to suggest that we either commit time this evening to a more fulsome discussion of all of those points, or that we kick this back to staff for a review of water districts who may or may not be in our area and do some benchmarking against other district policies and bring ours into line with both what staff thinks makes sense from a fiscal standpoint as well as what makes sense from a benchmark with other policies standpoint.
Okay, thank you.
The last time we discussed this, I was recommending that either that there be a ceiling, you know, a ceiling amount for these problems. I had one too, and it was $800 in Long Beach County, and it got down to 400 or whatever with the leak adjustment. But this is a lot of water. And you know, it's, you know, the homeowners have to share the burden for a leak, especially this size. I mean, this is really a lot of water. But however, I do think that there should be some sort of limit. I'm not sure what that dollar amount is. You know, I mean, last time I mentioned $1,000, I think maybe this, that might be a little bit late because of the amount of this water. This is a serious problem. And as a property owner, there's probably a duck pond in the back, you know, you need to keep an eye on this stuff. And if we just say, hey, you get a freebie on, you know, so bottom line is we need to have, you know, there needs to be a pretty serious fine with this. I'm not a fine, but a charge for this. But I believe that this ceiling needs to be in place because if the leak gets up to these $1,000 of work, I believe that this district has an obligation to put in a system that would be responsible to track and find these leaks. Not maybe just about meters or anything, but with a monitoring system with the district that can attack, not only see homeowner leaks, but leaks within, you know, because we have leaks, you know, on water main, et cetera, like that. So our water system needs to be improved so it could catch leaks like this. But the homeowner, sorry, I mean, I believe that the, you know, maybe it should be reduced a little bit, but I believe that this district should decide on some sort of, you know, ceiling, you know, with the, in conjunction with what we already have on the book.
Bill, I like where we're going with the count, but since you weren't here for the battle ordinance 8 days, I'll tell you, we got outdated numbers. So that's why I think rather than having a dollar amount, having some sort of percentage, because you don't want those things to get stale. You know, if we put a policy in place, we'd like to get one so the numbers don't get made quaint by inflation, for example. So that would be my approval there, is just put it as some sort of percentage. And I think it sounds like some other districts have done that in a variety of ways. So
sure, some base the percentage on an average of the customers' bills over the preceding 3 months, or the same month or the same billing period the prior year, or 3 years, or something like that. So you can baseline it against something comparable.
Okay, just a few comments first. I have some questions for Margaret in this. I appreciate Ms. Fraser bringing something. I asked, you know, I suggested that idea, and she did. The thing about her proposal, so the idea of it being, you know, covering two monthly periods, so it's one event, is absolutely correct. So that needs to be in there. Having a point at which the customer is no longer responsible at all, I think, should not be part of the policy. I think there are people who will game the system, and once it's become, you know, egregiously bad, then they're going to continue, you know, then that's kind of free water for a while or something. And there's all sorts of things that people can do, you know, water lawns in order to sell their houses. Okay. And so I think I don't think this proposal is right. I understand the sentiment, and I know this is like a very serious event in this person's life. So I think what we have tonight is whether we want to make a decision to essentially keep our existing policy with an aspirational goal of maybe sometime looking at it in the future, and of course, you know, working to get the, you know, Bill has mentioned things, you know, that we would, you know, like to have a leak detection system in place. Well, we're, you know, in 5 years we're going to have that basically when you roll out the rest of the Badger meters. But you know, in the meantime, Martin, would you feel comfortable this coming to admin to be looked at in admin? Okay, to shepherd it. Okay, and comment on it. Okay, or
yeah, absolutely. With the hopeful proviso that staff would also provide some fiscal input about what are the potential, where they think the inflection point is, where we are sufficiently rigorous to ensure that people are not going to, as you put it, game the system. Personally, I don't think very many would, but nevertheless, it is a valid concern. And that our district cost for addressing these kinds of leak events is also taken into account, but that it is not punitive, because it's enough of a pain in the neck and a hassle to have to, oh my gosh, I have a leak, oh, I have to fix it, oh, now I have to pay for the excess water. I don't think we're in the business of being punitive. We certainly want to be encouraging that people respond quickly and address it, but what's that balance?
I think the wording is important here. This policy is not meant to impose a penalty. I mean, it's actually a
gift.
It's a forgiveness of some of the expenses, okay, that are implied by our water rating system. So it's it may not feel like it at the time, but there is some generosity in offering as much as is offered. But I think we should have a little bit of a discussion here as to whether we want to continue this discussion after this meeting and a proper venue, which I think Director Bruce is saying might be appropriate. chairperson of that, that would be an appropriate suggestion. A new director?
Yeah, if the new guy can just talk through his schedule. So, I mean, I think the board, you know, setting policy is one thing, but, I mean, the board has the ability to make exceptions for specific cases, too. I mean, this is, and that's what you know, she's doing is kind of appealing for exceptions. Speaking with her more about the circumstances around this, it seemed like the configuration of her property and the water line involved, it was very unlikely that she would discover the leak. It was in a really remote area, and she didn't discover the leak. And the amount of the water was massive, and she still, you know, didn't discover it until it was noted, you know, reading the water meter or something. Talking to Rick about the whole situation, it was, you know, because of where the leak was, and how water is delivered to that location, it seemed unlikely that the district could have picked up on the fact that we were losing a probation tank with water in a pretty couple of weeks. Massively, but I like the idea of a maximum. I think as a district, we're producing more water than we're selling, and our leaks and the amount of water that we're losing out there is running about twice where it really should be. It's a kind of as a best practice, you know, as a percentage. We're like about 10% higher than we kind of should be, you know, even compared to other districts, you know, as a best practice. So I think it would be, you know, ingenuous of, I think it would be, we need to be flexible. given that we were running high, we have a high leak rate to begin with as a district, so I think it's important to be flexible with our customers at the same time. So I would support the idea of an exception for this particular case, and you know, take the policy to the admin committee, but make an exception for this customer to do what she suggested, which is you know, limit both, you know, set a maximum on what she should be paying for this particular week. Not setting policy, but just this particular week.
Well, my concern is, that's exactly why we have policies, so we don't make subjective decisions. And I understand what you're saying, that while we're in the process, because it's really difficult. And somebody at the last meeting, I can't remember, at May 17th, brought up, this is a very large dollar amount, clearly it's gonna hurt anybody. But some of those rate payers who had smaller lakes or smaller dollar amounts, for those people, that smaller dollar amount could well be even more financially burdensome. It just depends on your individual household circumstances. And I don't remember the specifics. We had a couple last year that were really large. And so that's why I think that subjectivity is a little bit tricky, because I would like to have a policy that is formulated to be, you know, fair to both the ratepayer and the other people in the district who are in some sense, you know, picking up the slack. That's my idea about doing a policy that can stay in place without specific numbers is sort of the end goal.
Yeah, so any of those former cases could have come for an exception, and they chose not to, so, but any of them could.
Well, we heard from, I believe, a couple of ratepayers in the last couple of years,
okay.
And like I say, every household has different, you know, financial situations.
Sure.
So the strict dollar amount is not always the best indicator of what an extreme hardship is. Although this, by any standard, this is extreme. I agree. Everybody has their, I have a toddler in a garden hose and a downhill neighbor story that I could tell you about a different water district. But, you know, we've all had bad things happen sooner or later with our water bills. So.
I guess I'd like to say I'm reluctant to make exceptions because there will be, you know, other times when we will be, you know, faced with that dilemma as to whether to have an exception, and then do we apply the same standard, and or, you know, are we consistent in that? You know, I think if we do anything, it has to go back, okay, and get fixed very quickly, so that whatever gets done is applicable to this person. And I think we have one commitment from one person who is inclined in that direction. I'll join you on that. coming from this, that it's reasonable to do this, and that, you know, we'll be able to deal with this in a timely manner. So somebody needs, you know, somebody needs to do the research. I think tasking that with committee members is probably not the best. I think staff needs to do that. And I would like for staff to, you know, buy into that, okay? You know, at least soul be, to be willing at least. So, anybody else want to, okay, do we have a, are we getting to an opinion here?
I
have different views on this.
No, I'm a make it a policy person, and I think if the admin committee has the time to get it done quickly. You know, it's not really complicated. We've already got some staff given this some thought, we've given this some thought, we've got some suggestions from members of the public. I think that's a good idea to fast track it.
Okay.
But in a form where there can be more discussion, a little bit more research before we make a decision. I like the idea of bringing in templates from other districts as a marketing.
Can I just say?
Yes. Okay. Special exception for this one.
So this is you guys all agree this is an exceptional situation. And at the same time, we don't want to react and do policies because of exceptional situations, but we also don't want to break the policy because the policy should apply equally to everybody, regardless of the situation. So there's a bit of a catch 22 there, right? So I just want to make that clear. And the other thing I want to say is, I don't understand how anybody can game the system. I totally don't want to, I think anybody should be getting free water or anything like that, but I don't understand how anybody can game a system where there is a one-time adjustment. You know, like, it's not like you can get another adjustment later and game it. I don't understand the gaming the system, what you're worried about there. And my third point is, this is really a non-issue in 5 years from now when everyone's got smart meter, when people have that meter. So it's just a temporary situation until people have the meters. That is one of the reasons. Thank you.
I will respond only. Gaming is too strong a word, but I did have one neighbor who put in a lawn underneath redwood trees for the purpose of selling their property, and that lawn is, never sold the property, and that lawn is long gone. So there are unusual uses that, I doubt very seriously what they put in the request for a leak adjustment on that basis, but. Anyway, okay, thank you for the talk. Anybody else?
Chair Bobby?
Yes.
I just want to clarify what staff is hearing and get a potential schedule out there for consideration. This leak adjustment policy is going to be remanded back to the administration committee. The next meeting of the administration committee meeting is on July 11th. Staff is being tasked with presenting a proposed leak adjustment policy with the balance that has been discussed, and also bringing forth discussion and samples from other agencies to the admin committee, so the admin committee can compare and contrast. If the admin committee is willing to commit to making a recommendation on July 11th, staff can get this back onto the board agenda for the July 19th meeting. So it would be a month delay, and as I understand too, then what the board is also considering is giving Ms. Frazier another 30 days before she actually has an answer.
Okay.
That's my understanding.
And just information on the logistics of this, I won't be in California on July 11th, but Margaret has managed to make her presence known here tonight, so we can work out something on that if that's agreeable to the chair of the committee. I assume that's the case.
Sure. Absolutely.
Okay.
If the committee can coordinate a different meeting date earlier than the 11th, but not too early, because we still have some research to do on the staff side.
I'm leaving on the 4th of July.
So it doesn't matter.
So it doesn't matter. I will put most of the elements on Margaret for doing the face-to-face communications that it helps to be able to do, but I'll commit to making every effort to be present remotely at that time. So.
I will do my part, happily. community member for her patients in this process.
Okay. Very well.
If the intent behind any of that was to do more than refer it to the admin committee, then we would have a motion. But if this is really just a referral to the committee, no action is required.
Okay.
I did not see the need for action.
Okay. I think that's enough. Okay. For this. Very well. Last one, please.
Just a quick question. I want to make sure this woman is not being penalized because she hasn't been paid, so.
No.
They're not going to be paying.
Well, not now.
For like trying.
No, they've been really reasonable.
Just want to make sure that, thank you. You're okay.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment? Michelle, had the opportunity. I don't see anybody, so I hope so. This item, thank you for coming again, and I hope we can work out something that may not be perfect, but maybe a little bit better. Okay. Let's move on to the next item on tonight's agenda, which is the Sand Hills Management and Monitoring Plan for the district's conservation area within the Olympia Watershed property.
Staff is recommending that the board award a contract to Jody McGraw for doing the preparation of the required habitat management monitoring plan for the conservation set aside at the Olympia Wellfield. This is, in effect, an extension of services for Jody McGraw. She's been working with us on this regard for quite some time, and this is an additional requirement that we have regarding the conservation set aside for this area. So staff is hopeful that the board can approve this tonight.
I'm familiar with Jody, exemplary on all things Sand Hills. I have only fairly unimportant comments, so let this go to anybody else first who would like to of the board.
I would.
Okay.
I think this, we have a spending problem with a lot of these environmental requirements, and it's really, in my opinion, kind of giving environmentalism a bad name, because actually the probation tank project is going to benefit the environment because it's going to give us more water storage. We need more water storage, so that'll prevent less overdrafting in the groundwater basin, and it's very close to where really where there was actually large earth moving machines next to the Hanson Quarry. And bottom line, what happens with these construction projects, yes, there are a lot of the plants and animals or whatever, they do get, removed to build a water tank up there. But the bottom line is they don't get wiped out, they don't get extinct, So over the years, we've really created this whole industry of, paying people to do studies and for permit requirements, et cetera, to do all this environmental work, which I don't believe the ratepayers of this water district should be obligated. Obviously, we're not going to stop. This is a long issue that's, we see time and time again that we need to confront and to do it. And this is going to get, I'm going to tie this into something else that's going on. But I'm not saying no, let's just say no to every time there's a, the state Fish and Wildlife says, oh, we got to make sure that we don't do this or do that. I'm just saying, hey, let's, say, talk to them. They're not lawmakers, they're rulemakers. And so they need to be negotiating. Look, we're not gonna kill off all your little bugs here. We're not gonna do this and stuff like that. And I'm a penny pincher, okay? I look at money and I look at what the value of money is to do. And I also am a strong environmentalist, so this isn't really true environmentalism. It's expanding the business. It's putting the name environmentalism on to make money to do things to do it. This proposed study, nobody's going to ever look at it. It's going to get done, and it'll look all nice and stuff like that, but it won't be useful really for anything. You know, the best thing to do with the environment is to leave it alone and not do it. So we don't, anyway, we don't really need this study. Now, the funny thing is about this, this is right where we have the Scotts Broom problem. Okay. And I don't know if you recall, last April I said, let's consider manual pulling with biological monitoring. And that's where I think this would be useful to have a biological, to pay for a biological monitor during the manual pulling. And that way, because you know that there's a pro use of Roundup people, and they're the people that I represent are the people to ban herbicides, ban pesticides use in the entire valley. And it's just because it's the water district, and I've heard the excuse that the water district said, oh, well, the county does it. Well, sorry, I mean, the county just agreed to stop using Roundup from forests, it said. But the same thing that Rachel Carson faced in 1963 is you have scientists come in and they go towards the more complicated sciences of studying chemicals. And that science is very, very complex, and it's unsolvable. So we have this blue ribbon panel, but which we don't have not been keeping records of the minutes of this meeting. So
Bill, I don't want to interrupt you, but these are topics for perhaps a discussion for which that's agendized. We need to decide whether to contract for a required habitat management.
I'm almost finished.
Okay.
I know this is boring because it might be kind of complex for people to know. Okay, so I see some nods here, they're getting it. The blue ribbon panel, from the information that I have, is they're leaning towards studying the science of the chemical effects of glyphosate, which is very difficult science. And whether it's in the watershed or whatever, whether it causes cancer, who knows the effects on the bugs itself with the glyphosate. Anyway, this is a very complicated scientific study. They must consider my plan and manual pulling with biological monitoring, which is easily provable scientifically to see the negative effects of that, because all you would do is pull the plants and do biological studies, and actually, I'm almost done.
I'm almost done. How does it relate to? Can you bring this into this?
Yes, I'm bringing it in right now. I will not vote for this plan until I want a new proposal that this biological monitoring is done after we manually pull the Scotts Broom plants carefully. But we do this study in conjunction with it. So, in other words, it's about 6 acres. So we'll manually pull the Scotch broom, okay? We'll get a study, and then if it shows no negative results, then we can go ahead and manually pull the entire district without using Roundup. And this is very extremely important. People don't want to use Roundup in this thing. It's a big issue. So I don't see any reason why not we can't do that. And that's how I tied it in. Thank you.
I'd like to bring this to staff. Can you give a brief summary of the legal requirement of having a habitat management monitoring plan for the well field, and why we need that? And okay, either of you.
Created, which is agreed to, which we've already approved And we've already been issued the permit for some of the projects that are going to be mitigated through this habitat conservation plan. This is a lot of jargon, but basically, the San Lorenzo Valley Water District operates a lot of infrastructure in Sand Hills habitat in order to provide water to the customers who live in Sand Hills habitat. And when we're going to do maintenance or repairs on infrastructure in Sand Hills habitat, there are impacts to the species, endangered species that are in those habitats where we have to do construction. So this is a habitat conservation plan, but what it is it's compensating for the impacts to the endangered species on future projects, including the probation tank, including the wells that we are replacing, including the future pipeline that will have impacts on Sand Hills habitat and endangered species that live in that habitat. So this habitat conservation plan was written and adopted by the board back in 2016, and we've already been issued several permits on it, and now, as in our agreements, we've agreed to write a management plan for the 6.7 acres set aside that will be protected in permanent protected status in perpetuity. And so this management plan will be what the Water District will look to over the years to manage, monitor, and protect that very high quality Sand Hills habitat that we're protecting.
I'd like to add, this was referred to repeatedly as a study. It is not a study, it is actually an action plan.
And part of that will be to monitor endangered species and ensure that they're persisting, and to, in the management, whatever, if endangered species come in, and to deal with those first, and to always make sure that we're maintaining the high quality status of Sand Parkland habitat on that 6.7 acre set aside, which is on the same property as the 60-80 acre parcel that we're also managing, but this is sort of a separate high quality set aside this is a special habitat management plan just for this set aside, not for the entire property. Just to clarify.
And Jen's done a brilliant job putting this together. I mean, it's going to save the district hundreds of thousands of dollars compared to the options, which were to go buy land with other mitigation banks that exist out there. We wouldn't have to pay $300,000 this year to buy that land to get the permit for the probation tank. But we don't have to do that because Jen's created our own mitigation zone. And it's not only for this project, but for future projects. Well, we're set for the future and at a much lower cost.
And do I understand correctly that the question before the board at this moment is whether or not we agree with the environmental regulations that we have already agreed to, but it is, shall we approve this proposed contract to execute the agreement that we have already made a commitment to? The question is this person, is this resource whom we will use to conclude our commitment?
Correct.
Yes. Understood. I would make a motion.
Okay.
I would second that.
We're no more you're voting. okay. We have a motion on the table, so there will be a little more board discussion here before. Thank you. And then I'll bring it to the phone for discussion.
But I would like to throw my two cents in.
So go ahead.
Yeah, this is a non-discretionary kind of thing, you know, the plan is. But I do think that Jeremy McGraw is, you know, well known in the area as being a specialist in this very special habitat. And we certainly benefit from having, you know, expertise already on board. So I think it's a very appropriate selection for this project. And so I think that she's an excellent choice.
No, I think Jeremy is an excellent choice. And I think there aren't that many. Okay, we must have to select somebody who has some credentials, okay, in producing a management plan. Doing so internally, I think, probably wouldn't fly by somebody, would it? Okay. So, so this being non-discretionary, I don't see any other reasonable choice but to proceed with this. So, anybody in the public, if you'll be open to public comment on this. Ms. Gomez and I.
I just wanted to state that, as I understand it, according to what I've read about Sand Hills Habitat, it does have to be actively managed. It's not something you can just leave it alone, it's nature, it'll be fine. It's a type of habitat that it has to be constantly managed and cared for in an active way, or it will be lost. So I understand why this needs to be done, and thank you for all of your efforts to do that.
Anybody else?
Hi, Mark, thank you, Ben. I have no problem with the contract, but I'd like to know what the amount is. Problem is, we have about, I'd say about 300, maybe 500 acres of sand hills already in a sand hills preservation zone. It's administered by the county. There are certain stipulations and regulations already applying to that particular property. For example, if I, on my 1 acre in the sand hills, if I want to add a building, I have to set aside 30% of that property as a mitigation plan. What I would like to see in the language before we adopt this is that this mitigation study, this mitigation management of the HCP, the Habitat Conservation Plan, be applied to every property owner in the sand hills, because this could be blanketed as a total EIR requirement. If you look at CEQA closely, there's an allowance for that. So I don't want it to apply just to a six-acre piece. Director Spallman's correct. We need to use our money more wisely. And I would like to have a broad brush approach to every parcel that is located umbrella and under the land use conservation zone, known as sand hills. And you know what that map looks like. Thank you.
The cost of the contract is $24,617.76.
76 cents?
76
cents. It's in there.
It is what it is.
My concern is how it's applied to the rest. I'd like to see the language of how it's applied in the HCP language. I'm not so concerned about the money being spent. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, thank you. Any staff comment? This applies to our property. You'd save this money to set up this mitigation for our.
Staff's comment is I strongly support Mr. Lee's desire to put these requirements across the entire Sand Hills Habitat. We don't have that power. We agreed to do this for this.
And to get that permit. Don't shake your head.
This permit is strictly for district projects.
Then withdraw it and reapply it.
That's not enough.
You know that's not true.
Any other public comment on this item? I don't see any. So, okay. Close up public comment on this. Bring it back. We have a motion and a second. Any other further board discussion? I'd like to call for a voice vote on this.
President Bachman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Ratliff?
Yes.
Director Spallman?
No.
Wait, one more.
Oh, I'm sorry. Director Hayes?
Yes. Okay.
Motion passes.
Thank you. So, that concludes item 9E, and we'll move on to new business now, which is item A, section 10, San Lorenzo Valley Water District Committee. So, we have opening of the engineering committee, which will need to be a member of the board, and for the Montico Assessment District Oversight Committee, for a member of the public. And the recommendation is that the board tonight fill the engineering committee open and direct staff to advertise for members of the public to for the Montego Assessment District Oversight Committee.
Chair?
Yes.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
We currently have immediately start seeking applications?
Not under this agenda item. Just, I'm not certain that the staff has the authority to do that without a board director.
That's what I would ask.
I can do that.
Okay. Any other staff discussion on this item?
I think it's pretty clear on this one, I hope.
Thank you. First, open it to the public. Anybody in the public would like to comment on this item?
Yeah, I was very excited to see this about opening on the LIAC committee. The first going to the engineering committee, I would like to recommend that John Hayes be appointed to that. He's very familiar with all the projects, the finance, and familiar with the finance of the district. And I think that his input on that is, not that he doesn't have an engineering background, but the financial aspect of it would be really helpful. Among all the board members available, I think that he would be the best choice for that. As far as the LIAC committee, I think a lot of this is going to depend on item 10E. The board decides to how they decide to react to the grand jury report and recommendations. And in advance of that, I'm hopeful that you're going to adopt all the recommendations, because that's just so exciting going forward. It is so exciting that I'm going to apply for the LIAC position. The idea of getting trained and producing a report is exactly where they should have gone from the beginning, and I'd love to be a part of that. I'd love to be part of that team. Not only me, but I think this is going to be attractive to a lot more people in Montego that you're actually going to be able to do something and be accountable and report back to Montego. So I appreciate the board doing everything they can to fulfill that for that.
Thank you.
Bruce Holloway from Boulder Creek. The district manager was incorrect when he said that there's three members on the finance committee, because the third position is for someone who's not on the board. And so when the board appointed Mr. Hayes as a director, he went off the finance committee. So there's still two board members on the finance committee.
Any other member of the public? I don't see any other from the public, so I'll bring it back to the board. There are a number of ways in which we could address this opening on the engineering committee this evening. It could be either Mr. Hayes, or it could be one of the other directors who could possibly be appointed to that committee, and Mr. Hayes could be appointed to a different committee. So I would like for everybody to think about those possibilities. And just to not be too vague on this, one of the possibilities would be for myself to move to engineering. And I think Eric, excellent financial person. Okay, John might be a very good first position to be on finance. So anyway, any other board thoughts on this matter?
I have to appoint John to the engineering committee.
I hadn't thought about the switch. I was sort of paying to lose John on finance, just because we have a real grasp of the detail and sort of big picture as well, which is so useful. But I understand the issue. Also, I want to solicit, your interest, your.
Yeah, I think we have a lot of great momentum in the finance committee right now. I think that would be probably the best fit for me. Chuck's got a much more engineering background than I do, certainly. And I think it's important to have a functioning engineering committee right now along with what Deborah said. I think that's great, too. So I think Chuck can bring a lot of organization and direction to that. Right now, I think that'd be really helpful. I agree with Chuck.
Thank you. Margaret, do you have any thoughts?
I would defer to your judgment, Chuck, as chair of the board, and to John's preference.
Okay. Well, it's time for somebody to make a motion. Okay.
I motion that, that John Hayes be chosen as a director member of the Budget Finance Committee, and that Chuck Hoffman be chosen to fill the vacancy on the Engineering Committee.
Okay.
As in the regular position.
I'm going to ask your opinion just a moment, Margaret, we're having a good vote, sorry.
Sure. I'm questioning whether we can appoint anybody to the Budget Finance Committee meeting tonight.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, because that's not on the agenda. Okay.
That's true.
Thank you, okay, for catching that, but we could make the first step in the process.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Well, and to respond to your earlier question, Ryan, board direction is not required to start the process of advertising.
Okay.
We'll see.
For what? Okay.
For Budget Finance.
For Budget Finance.
Public member.
Can I amend my motion?
Yes.
I will amend my motion to propose that Chuck Hoffman be appointed to fill the vacancy as the director on the Engineering Committee.
Okay, thank you. Do I hear a second?
A second.
Okay. Is there any other board discussion? Okay, see me? So Holly, would you call over on this?
President Hoffman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
No.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratner?
Yes.
Okay. And then as far as filling the Engineering Committee meeting, is it?
I did that.
Okay, and, oh, well, we need to do the other, the item on there, which is to advertise to the public that there's an opening on LADOC, so let me take it to the public first. Any comments on this opening, taking this to the public for solicitation for application? I see no one in the public, so we'll bring it back to the board.
Can a community member be on two committees?
We haven't discussed that at any point. I don't.
There's no restriction on the board.
I don't see any restriction. So I would say put in an application, and I think I need.
No, Jenny Lopez, she's on both because she's on.
She didn't hear you speak louder.
Well, if you'll nominate somebody else.
Yeah, I think Ryan's person, she's well-headed.
Well, maybe she just heard you, so if one goes to the public, I assume somebody heard.
They're nominating some for all committees.
Oh, no.
That'll do.
First committee.
Okay, so any other public? I don't see. So let's do.
This really doesn't require.
My requirement.
We're actually supposed to choose to.
Do we choose to? Okay, so consider themselves directed by.
Absent direction not to, we will proceed with seeking application for the LADOC committee and the Budget Finance Committee.
Okay. Okay, let's move on to the next item on the agenda, which is item 10B, a resolution of appreciation for Eric Hammer. And recommendation is to review this room and approve the attached resolution of appreciation for Eric Hammer director. So I think in matters like this, it's appropriate for someone to read a resolution of appreciation, and as board president, I would like to do that. So, whereas on December 18, 2014, Eric Hammer took the oath of office to serve as director of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District Board of Directors, and whereas Director Hammer served on the board until his resignation on May 23, 2018, and whereas Director Hammer served on the Communications, Environmental, Administration, and Engineering Committees, and whereas during Eric Hammer's term on the board, the district received a District Transparency Certificate of Excellence from Special District Leadership Foundation, and whereas also during his term on the board, enterprise 2, 3, 4, and 6 were completed, and whereas Director Hammer was instrumental in the capital improvement program and the rate structuring process, as well as numerous other projects, and whereas Eric Hammer is truly deserving of special recognition and commendation, recommendation for service to the San Lorenzo Valley Water District. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District that Eric Cameron is hereby commended for his years of devoted and dedicated service as a member of the Board of Directors to the San Lorenzo Valley Water District, that he has the deepest respect of all those who have been privileged to know and work with him, and that his outstanding effort and dedication will be sorely missed. So I'd like to give the other board members an opportunity to say anything.
You know, I can certainly endorse everything in the resolution. I served with Eric on a couple of different committees, and he brought a really great perspective, different from mine. He had a business orientation that I appreciated, and he had really deep, long-term local knowledge that was really invaluable, and you know, he really cares a lot about the district and the region, and I think it was really great to have him serve on the board. And I'm sorry that he's not able to continue.
Mark, is it Bill or okay? Mark?
I think the resolution speaks well for our regard and admiration for Director Hammer and our well wishes for him.
And finally, after having read the resolution, I want to say personally that I appreciate the time you put on there. I appreciate especially bringing his engineering perspective on that, and he had an awareness of the community that ran deep, and I think that was valuable to us. So I do appreciate the time he spent with us, and I am sorry that his health puts him in a position that he can't be doing this now. Is there anybody else who would like to comment at this point? Okay, then I would like to recommend that, I'm sorry. Okay, thank you, Gina. Public comment on this item. Is there any public comment? Okay, seeing none, bring it back to the board. I'd like to do this on, I think we can do this on a voice vote, or we'll do a roll call, just to be sure. So, Holly, could you, so the motion is to approve the attached resolution of appreciation for Eric Hammer. Thank you, Director. And second?
I'll second that.
Okay.
President Hoffman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
No.
Okay. Let's move on to item 10C, the award of contract for the cost of Kiembro well 6 replacement.
So, district is in need of replacement of a well, and we put together plans and specs and a contract and advertised it out for the bid. We received 4 bids back. They're listed in the agenda package. Staff is recommending award to Montiora Brothers in the sum of $425,345. And this is going to be a very important well for us as we move forward in our CFP program. So staff is very excited to get this one on. Okay. Staff is seeking board authorization.
Any additional board thoughts? I'll just comment that two of the bids came in quite close to each other towards the low end of the scale. The item on tonight, the recommendation for tonight is that the lowest of those two be approved. It does not seem like a difficult, to me, a decision to come to. So, any other comments? Anybody in the public want to comment on this? I don't see any, so I'll bring it back to the board. Any further discussion? So, Holly, could you? And I'll move the motion, is to approve the contract with Maggiore Brothers of Watsonville, California, in the sum of $425,000. Approved resolution number 25-17-18, the award of construction contract. The resolution reads, so that could be corrected, I hope. The Posse Camp, a well eight, which is the well six replacement.
I'll second.
Okay, any further board discussion? Seeing none, can I get a voice vote? I can get a roll call vote on this?
President Baumann?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Spalman?
Yes.
Okay. Said resolution is approved. So let's move on to item 10D, a water service agreement for APM 081-253-25.
This is actually more detailed, a water distribution system improvement agreement whereby the developer of the parcel is required to install facilities that will be turned over to the district for operation, pipelines, fire hydrants, things of that nature. And because of this project, we are having to go into our system and make improvements, but he's responsible to pay for them and he's responsible to make sure that they are installed correctly. And that's what we are asking for tonight, is that the board authorizes to enter an agreement to ensure that the facilities that he is required to install will be taken care of appropriately. Mr. Shaste has been working with us for the better part of 3 years now, at least, I think, right, and getting this done. So this is actually a pretty exciting project to move forward for him and for the district.
Okay. And this is that empty parcel that got cleaned off, not too many.
Yeah, it's not empty anymore.
Okay. Well, it's got a good foundation.
It's got a concrete foundation. It's just on the south end of Boulder Creek.
Across the water, then.
Correct.
Right. Okay. Any public discussion on this? I don't see any, so bring it back to the board. Oh, did I? Oh, I didn't see your hand. Please, please, please.
What was the total contract cost?
There is no price associated with the contract. He is responsible for constructing it. And we don't know necessarily what his costs are going to be, but we do know that they're going to be constructed to district standards.
We have any estimates?
We have a $500 inspection fee.
Yeah.
That would be deposited with the district. Yeah. But he'll put a fire hydrant in, and that'll be around $10,000. And then he has to put all his water meters and fire service in.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other public comment? Okay. I don't see any. Board comment? Okay, is that your motion?
I would move approval of resolution 27-17-18, agreement for water distribution system improvement, APN 081-253-25.
Okay, do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, any other discussion? Okay, none. Holly, could you call a vote on resolution number 27-17-18?
Yes. President Baumann?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Spalman?
Yes.
Thank you. Which brings us to the next to the last new business item, which is discussion of possible action by the board regarding the 2017-18 grand jury report. So, before I get started, I want to first ask the public input on this. Would anybody like to comment?
Yes. Grand jury report is awesome. I wanted to first thank some people. I want to thank the grand jury for their time and integrity in putting this together and all the work they did. And for the good news that it turns out we've been asking all the right questions. I want to thank LADOC for sticking with it. Members presently, Ruth Shaw, Lydia Hammond, Tony Norton. Tony, who was chair for a year and was like hacking through a jungle, she stayed with it. And also April Crittenden and John Bruno, who resigned, but who did just an amazing amount of work in very hard conditions. I want to thank Rick Rogers, our director of operations. He attended attended our, the first LADAC meeting for the first time, this last one, and it was a remarkable difference, and I hope that we'll be able to see him at more meetings. And I want to thank John Hayes, our new board member, for his interest in helping all the Long Beach projects move along. I sent a letter to the board on June 6th. Holly said she inadvertently forgot to put it in the agenda packet tonight. It's very short, I just want to read it paraphrase quickly. I request the board give full support and endorsement to all recommendations as outlined in the grand jury report on SLB released May 31st, and thus be done at the next board meeting or a special meeting, or as soon as possible to address this item on the agenda. I believe an immediate, responsive, written statement and press release from the board with your unequivocal, enthusiastic support to endorse and immediately begin all recommended changes prior to the response August due date will greatly benefit the district and make a positive and progressive statement to the public served. There are two items on Lompico and one item on transparency having to do with communications in the district. I think every single one of those recommendations will move this district forward into a new place. And I'm very hopeful that there's a new change and a wave coming, especially with the press banner report today that came out that there is a slate of three people whose top priority is stability and transparency. And I think we need to move on that. All the work putting together the Long Beach merger was done in a very positive atmosphere. We had the support of SLP, the staff at SLP, the county, our supervisor, our fire district, and Valley Women's Club all wrote letters of support and came to meetings and spoke in support. It was a very positive atmosphere. And when we hit the wall here in 2016, I didn't know what was happening. I don't understand it. But I think it all needs to be set aside, and we need to move forward in a whole different light. I'm especially happy to see, as I said earlier, the Long Beach Oversight Committee duties be resolved and enhanced. And as I said, anybody would love to be a part of that team. It's very exciting. This report recognizes and recommendations enhance the accountability and transparency for everyone in San Lorenzo Valley Water District. And I think, as I said, it'll be a big step forward. I encourage you to adopt all recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else in the public like to comment on this item? Mr. Lee?
Hi, thank you, gentlemen. I want to congratulate the grand jury for making recommendations. I thought it could have been a little bit more strenuous. And like Deborah Lowen, I agree that we should support the grand jury recommendations as fast as possible. And I'm glad there's a new slate coming up for election. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else want to comment? I don't see any of the hands up, so I'll bring it back to the board for discussion.
I was interested in the memorandum introducing this about the recommendation to take the draft response to LADAC, which I think is a very useful recommendation. So I thought that was a good point.
Okay. Anybody else?
And I don't, no, I mean, that was my initial foray at it. I wanted to endorse that as a good idea because it is the majority of the findings relate specifically to that region of the district. So I think that's an appropriate place to start.
I'll say that I agree with that. I think the elected be offered the opportunity to comment to a greater extent that they want to, and I hope that will be very wholesome. And that should be part of our process of getting to a response to the report. So anybody, I'd like to take the comments first, and then maybe I'll make some suggestions, maybe get ready for the board on how we might proceed. Anybody else?
Oh, I do want to
did?
No, anybody. I can go ahead and make suggestions.
Oh, well, I really like what Debbie said. So we move forward, and, you know, let's just face it, I mean, this assessment district was a complete failure on the district board, in my opinion. And so I'll just, you know, let's just let it go, let's move forward. And, you know, what is said that these grand jury reports are sort of complicated, you know, to really understand, but I think this district really needs to take time to look at it and do all the recommendations that are on this thing. And then hopefully, we do have an engineering committee meeting up this Monday that we can start making some improvements. And then also, I made agreements with spending more time going to the Wampico Oversight Committee. And, you know, for all those people that don't live on Wampico, and I think one of the big problems that people, the big mistake was, is that it got sort of political, where people were thinking that we were favoritizing Wampico. But let me assure you that this is a district-wide issue, because what I believe is that the Wampico budget for all its assessment district projects, if we don't do this correctly, we'll go over budget. And the people in Wampico, you know, we're only tied to the hook of $2.9 million. That extra money, that if it does go over budget, if we do not aggressively get these projects done, it will go over budget. And not only that, it's also exposing us to liability as well, because there's several items for fire protection.
Excuse me. No, I'm concerned because that isn't part of this particular agenda item. This is more about the process for preparing a response, because we need to make a response by August.
I think it's 29.
Okay.
We have a limited window.
Let me tie all that together again. That our response should include a response that we look past our past mistakes. I'm starting this thing, and then we are going to follow the grand jury report to a T.
What I have in mind, you know, this is an item on the agenda that is basically about how we will prepare a response. And you know, personally, I think that you know, I have a lot of appreciation for the work that the grand jury put in, and there's much of value in there. So I want to be sure that all directors' thoughts on this matter, mine, yourself, Bill, are brought in a way that reflects the, you know, not necessarily a consensus, but at least some level of agreement, some level of integration of the thoughts and feelings that the board has about this report. So these require crafting language in a way that I don't think can be done initially in a board, you know, context, and it needs a subset of, you know, of our board in order to get to it. So there's a couple of ways to do that. One would be to have the board president do that and bring a draft to the board. That's not my is not what I believe would be the best way to proceed on this. I think we should consider having an ad hoc committee of two board members to work on this. And my recommendation for this is that those two people be, and I'm certainly going to entertain other ideas, that those two people be myself and our new member, John Hayes, who has has not been on the board and has worked well with Wampico, and that we come and, after taking some input, perhaps at a special meeting to be held next week, okay, in which people could bring their thoughts to that. And after that, if at that meeting we chose to form an ad hoc committee, then we could take some of that input and then bring a draft, okay, response at some time. So this needs to be done precisely, and at any point, you know, I welcome comment from legal on this, but this is, I think, a reasonable thing to do, to bring in two people, okay, for a committee that will exist strictly for the time of to prepare a report and through the draft and try to get this as quickly as possible. And that probably means, you know, draft at July 29, and but possibly, or July 22nd, whatever, okay, or July 19th. So, but then come back at the latest for the August meeting. So, any other board?
I think that's a pretty ambitious schedule, but I think it makes sense. Because I really would, I don't want it coming to the August meeting because there's just not enough time to get input from everybody. So I think if it could be worked on and gotten back to our regular July meeting, that would be much preferable.
Okay. But what I am saying that we would have a special meeting a week from, from today, in which members of the public, members of the board could compose their thoughts, present them orally, or present them written, okay, at that time. And then at that meeting, we would consider finally whether to form an ad hoc committee at that time.
Well, my comment with this is I am the most qualified person to on the subject. I served on the People Board for 8 years. I know everything that's on this document pretty much by hand, and I'm not going to tell you how, but you know, because all that, when it was all done, it's all very confidential, but I'm just saying that, you know, I believe, you know, I don't really, you know, I just believe that we need to come up with a response. But my concern is that we interpret the grand jury report, we accept it, and we do the you know, the recommendations that, which I feel that I'm the most qualified person to implement.
I would support the chair's position that he should be the chair of the ad hoc committee, and I appreciate his nomination of John Hayes as his co-ad hoc board member. I would point out that once upon a time, the Long Eco Board itself had a grand jury investigation, and I don't believe that any of its findings were responded to besides the actual paper response. I'm not aware of any action Long Eco actually took to correct the findings.
Okay, thank you.
One
thing, I would also point out that if you wanted to convene during the evening a week from today, that landing on the Santa Margarita Groundwater Board of Directors meeting.
That's right. Well, then we would need to adjust that date, okay? And I think I'm open, so.
I would be open to another date, but I do think, you know, moving quickly is preferable.
Then perhaps, let me look at my schedule. Perhaps that Wednesday trip, people could look at schedules and see if
work a schedule offline.
Okay. Okay. Any other board thoughts on this? Okay. Then I will bring it to. Okay. Do I have a motion in this regard, or would you like for me to make a motion? I'll make a motion since I'm bringing the idea. Okay. So I'll make a motion that we schedule a special meeting next week, okay, at the earliest, okay, at the latest time possible so that people can gather their thoughts. So I'm hoping for Wednesday or Friday, but that can be determined later. And that ad hoc committee be composed of myself and John Hayes. And then the other aspect of this.
So that would just be a recommendation.
Right, it's a recommendation that we just bring that to that meeting for the discussion. So, and if we choose at that time to pick that, okay, to form that committee, then any inputs that people have brought to that meeting can be, will be public documents and can be part of the process of this ad hoc committee considering this. And the last part of this, like to consider is whether or not we should make this a recommendation at that committee that we have one or two members from LADOC on that committee. And I don't see Ms. Shaw here, anymore. So, then if staff has an understanding, then we'll leave it at that. That we'll schedule a special meeting next week.
Okay. Okay. I just have to take a word.
Please.
The Waupico grand jury report, just to correct Director Bruce, the main recommendation by the, 2010, can't even remember what year it was, but the main recommendation was to merge, and we did that. So, I don't know what, I really don't know what you're talking about.
And the board got accommodation for their actions.
Okay. Unless there's more board discussion on this, I'll close out this item. And the last item?
I beg your pardon, I thought a motion was made. Was it withdrawn?
That motion is withdrawn. And the last item on new business this evening is item 10F, ordering an election. And the recommendation is to the Board of Directors to review this memo and adopt resolution number 26-17-18, ordering an election, requesting Santa Cruz County elections to conduct the election and requesting consolidation of such election for Santa Cruz County Water District, as well as the notice of county clerk of elected officers to be filled. So, the rest of the material is in the item tonight, and I believe the only choice is to request a change of the statement regarding, 200 words or 400 words. And I looked at the last election I was in, the 200 words were used okay at that time. So, any staff with any thoughts needed on this? Any public discussion on that? Mr. Lee?
Question. We're ordering an election that's for November, and you're suggesting that we increase the verbiage for qualification in the narrative from 200 to 400 words for each candidate? I'm not clear on that.
No, I'm not recommending that.
I think what you're saying is that's the only discretionary item in this, right? That's
right.
The only decision you have to make other than
And the default position is 200 words. So I'm not. So there is no. I'm not making a recommendation to change that to 400 words.
Okay, so it remains as it stands currently. Okay.
And unless some discussion changes that opinion, that's the recommendation at the moment.
I see.
The mic.
Okay. I just want to be clear. Right. That's what you're. Oh yeah.
Okay. Any other public comment on this? I don't see any, so bring it back to the board.
I think 200 words is adequate.
Margaret, any thoughts on this?
No, I think it's just fine it the way it is. 200 words is fine. The election, doing this is not discretionary.
Right.
to conduct the election and requesting consolidation of the election.
One second.
Second.
Okay, 2 seconds. Okay, we're all seconded. Any other board discussion comments? I see none, I hear none. On the vote on this.
President Hoffman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
Yes.
Motion passes. That concludes the consent agenda. I mean, it concludes the new business agenda for this evening. We'll move on to the consent agenda. Does anybody have any member of the board wants to pull anything at this point? Hear none? Any member of the public want to comment on this item? I see no public member wanting to speak on this item, so I'll bring it back to the board. So, do I hear a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
Second. And no other further discussion? Pause, did you call for a vote on the consent agenda?
President Hoffman?
Yes.
Director Bruce?
Yes.
Director Hayes?
Yes.
Director Ratcliffe?
Yes.
Director Smallman?
Yes.
And we move on to district reports. Anything in particular that staff would like to?
I will defer to the admin report regarding what's written and answer any questions if there are any. And the next report after that, I believe, is, oh, just what I'm like. Can you make this, if you want to talk about?
Do you have any questions?
Steph has anything she wants to call out? Your end is coming up fast. Rick, how about you?
I was looking for the actual cover sheet. I haven't seen anything except looking forward to drilling the new well. Paso 7 rehab was completed. We're getting ready to put it back online. And production picking up. That's about it.
Staff is available to answer questions.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to bring it to the public at some point in this. So, on district reports, please bring any comments.
Yeah, I don't want to get up again. Admin report, Mr. Lee, you have in your last paragraph, staff is currently working with the engineering firm Shake and Wheeler on the proposal of the three reservoir sites. I couldn't find anywhere that was approved. You don't have to answer right now, but could you send me that information and when the board approved that? I wasn't aware that there were, the last thing I know was WSC, something like there were 60,000 and 250,000 for WSC reworking land, Montego budget. And like I said, you know, we're both looking puzzled here. If you could just fill me out, who is Shape and Wheeler and when were they approved by the board to be working on this?
Shape and Wheeler have not been approved by the board to work on this. That's why they are preparing a proposal so that staff can bring it back to the board with a recommendation to a board for them. Shape and Wheeler were one of the three firms that were selected to be the on-call as-needed engineering firms.
In December, you asked for that approval.
No, we actually did that just a couple months ago, and that was when the board formed an ad hoc committee to pursue this further, to have three engineering firms on board working with us on not only the USDA loan, but also the assessment project.
So they weren't approved, but they're getting a proposal to the board for the August meeting.
That's what we're hoping.
And I assume more than Montego projects. You were talking about the whole CIP $15 million projects of giving all that up, right?
This is strictly for the assessment district three tank projects. We're looking for presenting a proposal to the board to begin design on three tanks.
Okay, I have not seen that RFP.
I understand.
Okay.
district council, without having read the legal report, was there anything,
Is this proper to, okay? Okay, go ahead, okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
In the legal report, was there anything that came out of the closed session that referred to any litigation other than the current cases that are being litigated? Is the question.
There were two statements read out of the closed session. Maybe, were you here?
No, I was not.
Then those, I don't think it's necessary to read those, but those will be part of the minutes, okay, of tonight's meeting. So, yes, there were two reports out from closed session.
Okay, so they're online?
So they will be.
Okay, thank you.
Any other public comments? I don't see any, so, I'm back here. Any of the committees want to say anything, about their, okay, environment or, I think the meeting notes speak for themselves, so, I don't have that. Okay, and then, any directors', communications?
Yes. I did want to mention there were a couple of events. There was a, meeting held last week in Belton Communities, Center about the County Park Library Water District, project where, the Water District's curbing plant is adjacent to the new county park and public library that's going to be built in Belton, and our environmental staff has been working with the county, and we have provided an easement for litigation to help the county parks. And that just sounds like a really great project. It's a great opportunity for watershed education, and it's just one of those very happy coincidence where everything is sort of synergistic and everybody wins in this one. It's, they're going to be maintaining property that we cannot use, and they'll be maintaining property that we can't use in order to mitigation. And everybody that heard about it there, there was the public safety, very happy about this project. We're only involved very peripherally, but I know that our environmental department staff has been working quite diligently with county parks on that, and public works, I believe. And the other thing was the groundwater summit. Are you going to be talking about that at all?
Go ahead, I can.
As a director of the Santa Margarita Groundwater Authority, I was in Sacramento along with two directors from the city of Scotts Valley and their general manager. We attended a workshop and a symposium about the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act. Very, very useful. They had a lot of people there from the Department of Water Resources. They had a lot of technical staff, engineers, hydrologists, people of that sort. And they had a lot of people from critically overdrafted basins in other parts of the state that are 2 years ahead of us on the sustainable groundwater plans. So very practical, got a lot of really useful information regarding the legal requirements of the act and some of the complexities of actually putting together the plan. So it was a really useful event, and I got a lot of good contacts, particularly with the Department of Water Resources. I didn't know anybody there before, and I think that's going to be a great resource for us. So I was really happy that the Groundwater Agency enabled us all to attend.
I'll follow up back with reminding everybody that next week this Groundwater Sustainability Agency meets on the fourth Thursday, okay, which is the nature of the conflict this evening regarding setting up another meeting. And that there is scheduled to be a presentation from our hydrogeologist at that meeting, Nick Johnson. So this might be a very interesting meeting to attend, especially. GRA of California, Groundwater Resources Agency. California is the best venue in which, you know, to address the groundwater concerns. Aqua does a reasonable job at it, but they are spread more broadly. So, and I'll actually be listening a week from now to a webcast on groundwater modeling. So they provide some excellent, just as a, you know, from your desk, from my laptop alone. So anyway, don't forget about our groundwater agency and come on the, at the current, every 2 months, but that may be reconsidered if we're going into more groundwater sustainability plan development and may require meeting a bit more often. So, I think that's for me. Anybody else? Any other director of communication? Margaret?
Nothing for me out here in Sacramento. It's been the all energy channel, so I've got nothing to share.
Okay. And then solicitation of any meeting agenda items for next time from directors. I don't hear any. So that closes out district reports, and we have now written communications. And the informational material in our packet is available for anybody to peruse at the leisure. So at 8:39 p.m., we will adjourn the meeting. Thank you, everybody, for coming.